Greetings from the Petersburg Church of Christ. We thank you for allowing us into your home today, and we encourage you to open your Bible and follow along with the message that's presented today. We would also encourage you to take notes and send us any questions or comments that you have concerning today's message to the address that will be provided at the end of the lesson. We invite you to join us any opportunity that you have. We meet on Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock and Sunday evenings at 6 p.m. We also have a midweek Bible study on Wednesday evenings at 7 p.m. We are located at 205 Russell Street, just off the south side of the Petersburg Square.
Sometimes people get things mixed up and they don't always understand what certain words mean. The good illustration of a young mother who was worried about her 9-year-old son. No matter how she scolded him, he always went around with his shirt tail hanging out. And her neighbor across the street had 4 boys, and they never had their shirt tails out of their breeches. They never did look like her little boy. So she went to the mother of those little boys and she said, "I want to know the secret of how you keep your boys. Their shirts are always tucked in." The lady replied, "Oh, it's simple. I just take all their shirts and sew an edging of lace around the bottom." And they kept their pants over their shirts. They didn't want to be seen with that lace. That's what you call ingenuity. We're not talking about ingenuity this evening. We're talking about another word, influence. And what a word it is. And when you get to studying your Bible and begin looking at it, did you know the word influence only appears in the Bible one time? And that's in the Old Testament, at Job chapter 38. And what's interesting about Job 38 is that God is doing the talking to Job out of the whirlwind, beginning at verse 1 of chapter 38. And the word influence is in the plural in verse 31. But what's interesting is that God answers and talks to Job about some things that are strange. And many things are said in this chapter that until a lot of time has gone by and a lot of things have happened on earth, as man began to understand what God was saying to Job in chapter 38, but in a context of weather, in the context of these Pleiades, the stars in the heavens, word influence is used. Notice what it says. Let's start at verse 28 of Job 38. "Hath the rain a father? Or who hath begotten the drops of dew? Out of whose womb came the ice and the hoary frost of heaven? Who hath gendered it? The waters are hid as with stone, and the face of the deep is frozen. Canst thou bind the sweet influences of Pleiades, or loose the bands of Orion? Canst thou bring forth Meseroth in his season, or canst thou guide Arcturus with his sons?" Now, I don't pretend to know everything about that passage of Scripture. There's a lot of things there that I don't understand. I don't know exactly what is being said. But there's a couple of observations I like to make that I think are good and sound and reasonable. That here, the only time the Bible uses the word influence, and it's in the plural. And the influences of the Bible, of the people who lived in the Bible, were many. There were different characters who had influence upon other people and on their families. So I think we're safe to say that influence is a vast topic. It is one that you cannot say that it's just a one-time situation and that's all there is to it, because influence is something that is plural in great number. And some would try to say, well, this passage of Scripture is talking about the influences of the zodiac, of the astrology and the stars, since the Pleiades, and if you do your homework on that verse, there were seven stars in the Pleiades arrangement. And the suggestion here is that the Pleiades had influences upon other things. But I get that word out front so we can come to grips with the topic and realize that the subject of influence is not one that you can pass off in just a few minutes. That the subject of influence is one that was in the Old Testament, that it was in the life of Job in this passage of Scripture, within the life of the prophets, within the life of Jesus. Influence is a tremendous subject, and there is not a soul that has ever lived on the face of the earth has ever escaped the influence of influences. Somebody wrote a prayer, as you don't give an author, unknown. The prayer said, I asked for strength, and God gave me difficulties to make me strong. I asked for wisdom, and God gave me problems to solve. I asked for prosperity, and God gave me a brain and brawn to work. I asked for courage, and God gave me danger to overcome. I asked for love, and God gave me troubled people to help. I asked for favors, and God gave me opportunities. I received nothing I asked for, yet everything I needed. I don't know whether you've ever noticed in your own prayers and your own personal life that many times the things that you pray for and ask God to help you with, that He doesn't answer those prayers the way you think He ought to. But you know, that's why God's God, and that's why you and me, we're here on the earth. The influence of Jehovah God in our prayers, in our Bible studies, in our personal lives, in our families, in the church, is phenomenal. You know, one of the verses we use quite often this morning in our lesson on the name of Jesus, look at one verse later. Acts 4 verse 12 was quoted several times in a lesson this morning. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Are you ready for verse 13? Immediately following this tremendous verse on salvation in the name of Jesus, the Bible says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. And they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. The influence of Jesus Christ upon these men here in the book of Acts made them bold. They were unlearned and ignorant as far as the world was concerned. But these people who saw the boldness of Peter and John, they marveled. Why did they marvel? Because they took knowledge that Jesus Christ had tremendous influence on them. Jesus came into the world and he influenced the world in which he came into. A little baby coming into the world, whether it was Jesus Christ or any other baby, has tremendous influence upon the family. I didn't know what it was to get up in the middle of the night until Brad came along. And I could tell some other things that won't be necessary. But the influence of a baby in your family will have a tremendous effect on mom, on dad, on your grocery budget. A little baby affects its family. But if you boil this down real good, really, you know there's not but two kinds of influence. Only two kinds. Well, we said a minute ago there were many examples of influence. That's right. But there's only two kinds of influence. Bad influence, good influence. And we've either got one or the other. There are many examples in the Bible of bad influence. Think about all those wives that old Solomon had. 700 wives and 300 and so, somebody said porcupines, but concubines. Think of the influence those women had on poor old Solomon. You look in your Bible and you see other people who had tremendously bad influence. Herod couldn't find Jesus through the wise men, so his influence was he killed all the babies 2 years and under. Bad influence. The influence of Jezebel, whether you're talking about the actual woman in the Old Testament or you're talking about the spiritual arrangement of Jezebel of Thyatira in the book of Revelation. Bad influence. But then there's good influence. When you think of a good woman who had tremendous influence, you think of an Old Testament character by the name of Esther. Queen Esther had a tremendous influence in her day and time, a good influence. In fact, she saved the Jews from being annihilated off the face of the earth. Paul in Caesar's household. Many, many examples of good influence. But don't forget this. Since there's only two kinds of influence, bad or good, you've either got one or the other. You've either got one or the other. And that's provoking to think about. I would hope and pray that in your own life, as you live for the Lord, that you would be a good influence on people you know, on your family, on people in the church. I would hate to think standing before God and having had a bad influence in the church where other people had followed my example and thrown their hands up in disgust and quit and didn't have anything to do with the Lord and the church. But then another side to this idea of influence that I think we need to talk about. We're born with it. We can't lose our influence. We'll never be able to put our influence into the coffin with us when we leave. But there is another angle. And bear with me. This one's serious. This one's horrible. I don't know whether you are aware of this influence that's going on in our world today. The first time the document was put in print was in 1933. It was called Humanist Manifesto 1. And about 1973, that humanist manifesto was updated. And they changed it a little bit. Do you know what the humanist manifesto is? It is a document that was put in circulation in this country, dedicated to changing things in another direction. Our young people are suffering from it. Our country is stumbling and falling on its knees because of the humanism that is running rampant in our country. I don't want to add anything to or take anything away, but let me share with you what Humanist Manifesto 1 said. The Manifesto 1 of the humanist doctrine come up with the idea that the universe is self-existing and not created. They make no bones about it. There's no such thing as God. There's no such thing as a creator. Another idea that the Humanist Manifesto espouses is that man is a part of nature and that he has emerged as a result of a continuous process. In other words, man has evolved. He is no more than an animal. That's what the humanists believe. And their influence is raging through this country. A third position that the Humanist Manifesto 1 took was that humanism asserts that the nature of the universe depicted by modern science makes unacceptable any supernatural or cosmic guarantees of human values. In other words, there's no such thing as absolute right and absolute wrong. Another facet of the Humanist Manifesto 1 was that the religious humanism considers the complete realization of human personality to be the end of man's life and seeks its development and fulfillment in the here and now. In other words, there is no such thing as an afterlife. Self-realization in this world today is the real goal that man has. Well, then it was updated, and listen to some of the changes that they made in this document. This thing's in print. It's not just figment of imagination. They circulated it. They are circulating it. They want people to believe it. Manifesto 2 says, we find insufficient evidence for belief in the existence of the supernatural. They make no bones about it. No God. You go to anybody and your associates and your friends and you go to school with that takes the very calm position, there's no such thing as God. Where'd they get it? Humanism. That's where they got it. Number two, no deity will save us. We must save ourselves. In other words, man is his own God. Number three, promises of immortal salvation or fear of eternal damnation are both illusory and harmful. There's no such thing as heaven or hell. You know anybody that believes that? I know quite a few. Another facet of Human Manifesto 2 was that ethics is autonomous and situational, needing no theological or ideological sanction. Again, no absolute right, no absolute wrong. Here's a little new one now. We're talking about a doctrine that is infiltrating our country and in the minds of our young people in schools all over this country. The idea in the area of sexuality. We believe that intolerant attitudes often cultivated by orthodox religions and puritanical cultures unduly repress sexual conduct. The right to birth control, abortion, and divorce should be recognized. In other words, there's no religious guidelines for morality. Another one, short of harming others or compelling them to do likewise, individuals should be permitted to express their sexual proclivities and pursue their lifestyles as they desire. In other words, homosexuality is to be endorsed. And last of all, rather, science affirms that the human species is an emergence from natural evolutionary processes. The belief in evolution is being forced down the minds and the lives of our young people in the schools and in the colleges of this country. Well, let's answer some of this biblically. Let's deal with some of this, and we won't have a lot of time to get this in. But it's quite evident that the doctrine of humanism is teaching people that there is no such thing as God. Well, do you know what the Bible says about that? Let me give you a couple of real strong verses. The Old Testament in Psalm 14 verse 1 made the statement, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." I'm glad the Bible said that, because I don't want to be personal clash with anybody that doesn't believe in God. But it's quite evident that the Scripture takes a pretty strong position in calling a person who doesn't believe in God a fool. Well, look at another passage. In Romans chapter 1, beginning at verse 19. "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the man, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient." You see how strong a passage of Scripture this is? I didn't add a word. I didn't take a word away from. I believe the Bible has a perfect description here of a person who has left God out of their knowledge. They're worshiping other gods. A corrupt lifestyle has developed in their lives. And who can you blame for it? Humanism in our society. This humanistic attitude has been something that God was dealing with even in the days in which the Bible was inspired. Yes, the Bible takes a strong stand against the number one manifesto. If you believe what the Bible says, you can't accept the humanist doctrine. They believe that we are evolved creatures, that we have come along as a result of the evolution process. If the Bible means what it says, and it does, there's no such thing. It can't be. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He spoke them into existence. They did not evolve from something else. If theory of evolution is true, what are you going to do with the fact that God made Adam absolutely full grown? And when he put him to sleep and took a rib out of his side, Eve did not grow up from a little baby. She was created into a full grown woman. And then we had those who come along who said, well, God used the theistic evolutionary process to create things in the book of Genesis. I don't believe for 1 minute that that's so. I have been absolutely amazed at some of the thoughts that I've read in some of our own people's writings concerning theistic evolution. Where did evolution come from? Humanistic teaching, that's where it came from. Things have gone a long ways in the wrong direction because of humanism in our day and time. Another biblical thought, if there's such a thing as the humanistic idea that there are different standards of morality, what are we going to do with statements like this? Jeremiah said, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his own steps. There's no way man can direct his own steps. It's not in man that walketh to know what's right and what's wrong. It took a loving heavenly Father who would make it clear in his word what's right and what's wrong. And Jesus came along and he lived it. Different standards of morality came out of the doctrine of humanism. And we're living in a society today that's eat up with it. Then they say, well, you can do with your body whatever you please. If you want to smoke pot, if you want to dabble in drugs, if you want to snort a little cocaine, if you want to do the drug situation, it's your body, do as you please. That's not what the Bible says. You were there in Romans 1 a minute ago. Flip a couple pages. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 16. Know you not that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Here the Bible makes it very clear that the human body of people who exist on the face of the earth, that they are the temple of God. And you defile that body. You smoke it to death. You prick your arm until you're so addicted to the heroin and the drugs of our day. You're defiling the temple of God. Did you ever see the arm of a mainline heroin addict? Maybe you haven't. I have. The old boy was in jail in East Tennessee. I'd known him sometime. He's mainlining heroin. His arm from his elbow down looked like you had taken a wire bristle brush and had beat it into the flesh. He had shot heroin into his system so many times. And you know what that man did? he hung himself by a bed sheet on jail cell wall. He destroyed himself. And that's where drug addiction takes people in our society. We've been told a lot of doctrines, but one that replaces God, that replaces right from wrong, that gets us to believing theories that's not true, is the doctrine of humanism. How long we could go, and time's running out. But I hope I've at least opened the door where you can see that we need to talk about the subject of influence, because we can change gears and get into another area, and change gears and get into another area, and just keep on going. Because influence is tremendous. You either got bad or you got good. It is the ability to affect other people by your own ideas and your own lifestyle and what you believe. Jesus was a tremendous, influential man who walked the face of the earth. And we'll talk about that too. But I hope and pray that you'll share some of these invitations with people and get them to come with you to the services. And let's deal with this subject of influence, because there are people in this community that will either be lost or saved depending upon our influence upon them. And we need to do everything we can in our power to help them. If we can help you in any way, if you need prayers of the church, you need to send us a request for a Bible correspondence course. If you want to engage yourself in a home Bible study, if you would like for us to talk in some way, let us know. Get in touch with us. If you're subject to the invitation of Jesus, would you come while we stand together and sing?
If you have questions or comments concerning today's lesson, you may send those to Petersburg Church of Christ, 205 Russell Street, Petersburg, Tennessee, 37144. Or you may email us at petersburgchurchofchrist@hotmail.com. You may also request a copy of today's lesson through the same method. Be sure to include today's date along with the station on which this program aired and the title of the lesson. We hope to see you again next week right here on this station at the same time.